Hello, this is Larry Wessels, introducing another of the many videos our ministry has produced on the subject of Islam over the years. You are about to hear an audio presentation by Christian Islamic expert and author, John Gilchrist. John Gilchrist reads and speaks Arabic and is from South Africa. He has written the following books: Facing the Muslim Challenge, Sharing the Gospel with Muslims, Muhammad, the Prophet of Islam, the Quran, the Scripture of Islam, Jam al-Quran, the Codification of the Quran Text, Muhammad and the Religion of Islam, and The Christian Witness to the Muslim. His books have been translated into Arabic, Albanian, Chinese, Dutch, Finnish, Indonesian, Malay, and Russian. He is engaged in public debates with local Muslims in South Africa, such as Ahmed Dadat, Adam Pirmhai, Bashir Fania, and Yusuf Bakas. Our ministry has produced other videos by John Gilchrist, such as Muslims Fake Gospel of Barnabas to Justify Islam, exposed by John Gilchrist, Morrison and Wessels, and Heaven in the Bible versus Heaven in the Quran by John Gilchrist, Christian expert on Islamic theology. You can find all of the over 65 videos our ministry has produced by going to our YouTube channel, See Answers TV. Once on our main See Answers TV channel, scroll down to our playlist called Dealing with Islam, Muslims, Sunni, Shiite, Alawites, Sufis, and click on the title. This will take you to our entire list of videos on the subject of Islam. Please also see our website, www.muslimhope.com, which deals with Islam from a Christian perspective and is extensively documented. Material on our Muslim Hope website has been translated into numerous languages. See also three newsletters on Islam with lead articles by John Gilchrist. To find these, go to another one of our websites called www.biblequery.org, and once on the homepage, move your cursor to the left-hand side of the webpage and scroll down until you find our newsletter section containing the newsletters on Islam. Feel free to print out these newsletters as well. With that said, we will now continue with our main presentation by John Gilchrist called Jesus is Sinless, While Muhammad and Others Are Not, According to the Quran and Islamic Hadiths. John Gilchrist's presentation will be immediately followed by a full-length presentation by Steve Morrison and myself on the same subject from one segment of our 10-hour, 10-part series called Answering Islam.
One of the basic beliefs of the Muslims is that all the prophets of God, or Allah, as the Muslims say, were sinless. This is a popular sentiment today which is held to throughout the Muslim world. And the word that is generally used for the sinlessness of the prophets is this word, isma. It is a word which basically means purity from sin. What we will be doing in this lecture is to analyze what the Qur'an teaches about the prophets of God and about this question of whether they were sinless or not. We acknowledge quite freely that this doctrine of isma, of sinlessness of the prophets, is one which is widely held to as a product of popular sentiment throughout the Muslim world. But whether it is a Quranic dogma or not remains to be seen. And so we will begin by looking briefly at the expressions used in the Qur'an for sin and for forgiveness, and we will then go through the teaching of the Qur'an about the prophets of God. We will then look at some of the names of God according to the Qur'an, and we will finally look at what the Qur'an teaches about Jesus Christ. Now, the Bible teaches, of course, that all men are sinners by nature. The prophets are hardly excepted. On the contrary, throughout the Bible one finds that the sins of the prophets are exposed to public view, particularly in the Old Testament, where one finds the characters of almost every prophet without exception blemished through one fault or another. And it is interesting to note that just as the Bible teaches that sin is something which man does in relation to God, in disobeying the will of God, and that he needs forgiveness for such sin, so the Quran teaches the same thing. One of the words used in the Quran for sin is the word zambika. It comes from three root letters in Arabic, a zal, a noon, and a ba. And the word used consistently in the Quran for forgiveness in one form or another, let's use some of the words used, yastaghfiruna, ask forgiveness, ghafar, very forgiving, ghafur, forgiving. One finds a wide selection of uses of the term for forgiveness, which derives from three letters in the Arabic language, aghoin, afa, and ra, or as we would put it in our alphabet, a G, an F, and an R. G-F-R. Any of the combinations of these three letters in the Quran always bring about this concept of forgiveness. Arabic nouns and words usually have these three root letters, not like our language where we have independent words for nouns and so on. In Arabic, you will find that three root letters invariably form the crux of a word which can be turned into a verb, into a noun, or into any other particular participle as you choose in one form or another. But usually from the root letters used, one can get the meaning of the word. And in Arabic, the only word that the Quran uses for forgiveness has these root letters G, F, and R. There's no other root word for forgiveness in the Quran. Now what about the prophets of God? They are spoken of quite often in the Quran. And what we have to discover in this lecture is whether the Quran teaches this dogma of the sinlessness of the prophets. And we will begin by looking at a teaching of a certain man called Dr. M.H. Durrani. He is a Muslim, comes from Pakistan, and this man has written a small publication called An Advisory Study on Infallibility of Prophets. And from this little publication, I'm going to give you certain quotes. On page 4, he says of the prophets of God, "They were all truthful, all worthy of regard, and were honorable, and none of them was insolent or disobedient to God." On the next page, page 5, "It is defiance of sacred authority to call the prophet sinful." Page 16, "Individually, none of the prophets is spoken of in the Holy Quran as having committed a sin. Therefore, the doctrine of the sinlessness of the prophets is unassailable." Page 75, "Sin or disobedience cannot be attributed to them." Well, the man makes his position very clear. He is under the strong impression that the Quran teaches unambiguously that the prophets are sinless. Now, I have extreme difficulty in reading the Quran to find any such doctrine taught in the book. The word isma, relating to sinlessness, is never used in the Quran. There's only one occasion in the whole book, in the 60th surah, in verse 10, where the roots for the word isma are found, and that is far from the context of sinlessness or of the prophets. And nowhere does one find in the Quran any strong, positive, unambiguous teaching to the effect that the prophets of God were sinless. That is not a Quranic dogma. The book goes nowhere out of its way to make such a point. But the question arises, if that is not so, does the Quran at any stage teach the alternative, and that is that the prophets of God were in fact sinners, and that they broke God's laws, and that they disobeyed the will of God at any time in their lives? Well, what we're going to do is to analyze certain passages in the Quran on precisely this point to discover what the book teaches about the prophets. And we begin with Adam. Now, Adam to the Christians was simply the first man. But according to the Quran, Adam, as he is known, was a prophet. And in the 20th surah, in verse 121, we read these words, "And Adam disobeyed his Lord and was led astray." Dari Abadi, in his translation, says that Adam disobeyed his Lord and he erred. And Muhammad Pickthall, Yusuf Ali, Tariq, various translators of the Quran, all use the word disobey to describe what Adam did when he ate the fruit of the tree in the garden. Now this man Durrani, as we've seen on page 75 of his little publication, says that sin or disobedience cannot be attributed to them, that is the prophets. And yet all of these translators have no doubt that the only construction that can be placed on this sentence is that Adam in fact disobeyed God, and the Quran teaches that quite plainly, and it is something that is universally recognized. Some say, oh well, he was forgiven afterwards. Whether he was or he wasn't, the issue is not whether the man was forgiven and made pure again. The issue is whether he sinned at all. And the question here is one which seems to be fairly obviously answered, because the Quran teaches that he disobeyed God. And this man, Durrani, tries to sidestep the plain statement of the Quran to this effect by referring to verse 114, shortly before this passage, where it is said of Adam that he forgot. And Durrani says, it was simply forgetfulness on his part to eat of the fruit of the tree. He forgot the commandment of God. And so he says that no sin can be attributed to Adam because he did not intend to disobey God. In reply to this, we must state that the Quran plainly teaches that it was not a mere forgetfulness that led to Adam's act of disobedience, but that he fell directly to the temptings of Satan. Surah 20, verse 120, Surah 2, verse 36. And we find that Satan had reasoned with Adam and had said he could lead him to a tree that never decays. And Adam fell for this tempting despite the fact that God had plainly warned him that Satan was an enemy. And Adam thus believed Satan and disobeyed God. And if this is not sin, then what is? It is hard to credit the suggestion that Adam forgot. This was the only command in a negative sense that God gave him. According to the Bible, God said to him, "You may eat of every fruit of the tree of the garden, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat." It was the only tree he was told not to eat of, and at the same time, this was a command which came directly from God himself. And the strange thing is that the Muslims, like this man Durrani, tried to suggest that it was mere forgetfulness on Adam's part. And I find it hard to believe that the first man that God created was so defective in his memory that he could not remember the one thing God told him not to do, particularly when the command came from God himself. That is beyond our powers of reasoning. We just cannot accept such a strange suggestion. And in fact, to go further, we can read what Surah 7 says about the disobedience of Adam. Verses 19 to 23 read as follows. "O Adam, dwell thou and thy wife in the garden, and enjoy as you wish, but approach not this tree, or you run into harm and transgression." Then began Satan to whisper suggestions to them, bringing openly before their minds all their shame that was hidden from them. And he said, "Your Lord only forbade you this tree, lest ye should become angels or such beings as live forever." And he swore to them both, that he was their sincere advisor. So by deceit he brought about their fall. When they tasted of the tree, their shame became manifest to them. And they began to sow together the leaves of the garden over their bodies, and their Lord called unto them, Did I not forbid you that tree, and tell you that Satan was an avowed enemy unto you? They said, Our Lord, we have wronged our own souls. If thou forgive us not, and bestow not upon us thy mercy, we shall certainly be lost. And men have the daring to suggest, in the light of a passage like that, that Adam had never sinned against God. And as I say, if that was not sin against God, then what is sin against God? If someone can define sin against God rationally, logically, in any other terms other than what we find in this passage, it would be very interesting to see how the definition would read. It is quite plain from this passage that Satan himself reminded Adam and Eve that God had forbade them to eat of the tree of the garden, and it is extremely difficult to entertain the suggestion that Adam forgot. This was one of the most unlikely things that a man could ever forget. The only command God gave him, the one thing he told him not to do, Satan himself reminds him of the command, still he eats, and a man like Durrani wants us to believe that Adam had a short memory and that he forgot. It's beyond our powers of understanding. Even in verse 27, we read these words that Allah allegedly speaking says, O children of Adam, let not Satan seduce you in the same manner as he got your parents out of the garden. Yet we are led to believe that we are the ones who sin and not our first fathers Adam and Eve. And we understand the Quran to teach us justice about Adam. That God warned Adam that Satan was an enemy, and he gave a law, a commandment, that Adam should not approach a tree. Satan reasoned with Adam. God warned Adam that he would sin if he came to the tree. You see the word transgression in the passage. Satan reminded Adam of the fact that God had forbidden him to come to the tree, but still persuaded him to disobey God. There can be no cozy, soft argument about forgetfulness here. For Adam was in fact reminded by Satan that the tree was forbidden by God. But Adam chose to disbelieve and to disobey God and to render homage to the persuasion of Satan instead. And our reasonable conclusion from this is that Adam sinned, and grievously so. He had the express and great privilege of hearing the commandment of God from God himself, but despite this, still chose the way of Satan. If Adam did not sin, then who has ever sinned? Because what is sin, other than what Adam did? It was a grievous sin, a deliberate act of disobedience, and the Quran calls a spade. It calls it just what it was, a transgression, a wrongdoing. And we find that as a result of this disobedience, Adam and Eve were cast out of the garden and lost their exalted position because they chose to disobey God. In a flagrant disobedience. Surely any man of reasonable intelligence can see that. I cannot see how this can rationally be argued against, that this was an act of deliberate, calculated disobedience on the part of Adam. And according to the Quran, we find that Adam and Eve prayed that God would forgive them, and they knew that if he did not, they would be forever lost. Durrani says, Adam cannot be blamed for sin. And yet it is quite plain that God held him totally responsible for his misdeed and punished him most severely. To say that Adam did not sin is to strain the verses of the Quran and to force a theory clearly without support of the history of Adam in this book. We must conclude that this man, Durrani, is one of those many so-called expositors who does not allow the Quran to speak for itself, nor does he attempt to draw reasonable and objective conclusions from it. But he starts with a presupposition. He begins with a doctrine of the sinlessness of the prophets, not something he gets out of the Quran. And you will see in this lecture, it is impossible to get such a doctrine out of the Quran. And you will see as we proceed in this lecture how extremely difficult it is to try and read such a doctrine into the Quran. But it's a presupposition. It is something which the man is trying to force the Quran to yield. And in doing so, he has to resort to euphemisms, he has to twist what the Quran says, has to resort to all manner of textual dishonesty in his efforts to try and make this book say the opposite of what it is really saying. And one has to look into the Arabic here at this stage to see even more clearly that this suggestion that Adam never sinned is totally without foundation. The words in Surah 7, verse 23, are simply these. But when Adam and Eve prayed to Allah to forgive them, the words in Arabic are وَإِلَّمْ تَغْفِيرَ لَنَا, and that means, if you do not forgive us. And the word تَغْفِير is one of those many words in the Quran which is based on those root letters G-F-R, a ghayn, a fa, and a ra. And every word, as I say, in the Quran that has these letters as its root must surely mean forgiveness of one form or another, because there is no other word for forgiveness used in the whole book but words that derive from these three root letters, and there they are. And it's no wonder that all the translators without exception translate it as forgive, if you do not forgive us. And forgiveness comes in consequence of sin, nothing else. And one can see here that if you do not try to read an interpretation into the Quran, but you rather let it speak for itself, then there's only one conclusion that can be drawn, and that is that Adam sinned and he needed forgiveness. And as I say, in any event, if Adam did not bring in sin into the world, then we must ask who did. He was cast down, and in the Quran, he is the one who brought humanity into this predicament. According to the Quran, Allah says, don't let Satan seduce you as he seduced your forefathers. And yet we are being asked to believe that Adam did not sin. And if Adam did not sin, then we must ask who did. Who was the first man who sinned? Where did sin come from? How did it get introduced into the world? And if anyone says Satan introduced it to man, then I ask, if Adam was not the man that he introduced it to, in the light of what the Quran and the Bible teach, then who did he introduce it to? Because these two books are silent on any other alternative. Both books hold that sin came into the world through one man, through Adam. And one can see as well that this was not a small act of forgetfulness or a mere disobedience. It was a total act of defiance. God only commanded him not to do one thing as a test of his sincerity. And he did that very thing, and that was a total act of independence from God. It was no small thing that he did wrong. It was something which had immeasurable consequences. He was cast out of the garden, and with him the whole human race, because we were in his loins at that moment, and we are all descended from him, and we find ourselves in this world as it is because of his act of disobedience. And there can be no doubt that this man Adam was a sinner. One cannot see how anybody with a rational mind who thinks reasonably and logically can possibly draw any other conclusion from what is written in the pages of the Quran. And this brings us to the next prophet in the line, and that is the prophet Noah. And we read in Surah 11, verse 47, Durrani quotes this verse, that Noah said, unless thou forgive me and have mercy on me, I should indeed be lost. And let's look at the Arabic again to see what is exactly being said. The words are, unless thou forgive, same word, taghfir, from the root G-S-R, only possible interpretation that can be placed on the word. And have mercy on me, tarhamni, from the root letters from which we get the word rahmah, from which we get the word rahmah, mercy. In throughout the Quran, the beneficent one, the merciful one, ar-Rahman, the first name of Allah, in the 99 names. And we find too that he goes on, and he says, I should indeed be lost, khasirin. And these words are fairly strong words, and they yield only one possible interpretation. And that is that Noah prayed to God for forgiveness, knowing that if God did not have mercy on him, he would be lost. Those are not the words of a man who was without sin, who needed no forgiveness. Those are the words of a man who knew that he had faults of his own, and a man who, like any man on earth, would do, prayed for forgiveness. And if Noah was not a sinner, then why did he pray these words? And I go further, if he was not a sinner, then how would sinners pray for forgiveness if they did not use words like these? There's only one logical conclusion that can be drawn, and that is that Noah sinned against God. He needed forgiveness, GFR, tawfir. He prayed to the God of mercy. The word Rahman comes from the root letters R-H-M. And Hasirin, we find that's exactly what Adam said, that he would be one of the Hasirin as well, meaning one of those who was lost. But as I say, if these are not the words of sinners asking for forgiveness, then how would you recommend to a sinner to pray to God for forgiveness if people like Noah and Adam were sinless, infallible prophets who were praying for something else? And this leads me to the next prophet, and it is Abraham. And he says, Surah 26 and verse 82, who I ardently hope will forgive me on the day of judgment. Yaghfira is the word here, and it comes from the same letters, G-F-R. Yaghfira, meaning him, I pray that he will forgive me. It's the only possible interpretation that can be placed, and it's small wonder that all the translations of the Quran into English, whether from a Muslim side or from any other side, always use the same word, and that is forgive. Now this man Durrani concludes, he says, it is one thing to commit a mistake and quite a different one to go against the divine commandment. And whatever logic there is in that statement is past my comprehension, I can assure you. The hollowness of it needs very little exploring. If the faults of Abraham were just mistakes without culpability, then why did he ask for forgiveness? He wouldn't need forgiveness if they were just excusable mistakes. He could be excused. You excuse a man for a mistake, but you forgive a man for a sin. And one must be logical, one must be consistent in one's argument. And the verse implies quite plainly that it was possible that God would not forgive him. And no doubt, if he was not forgiven, would he just be one of these people who committed little mistakes along the way and had nothing to account to God for? Why then do people like Noah and Adam and others say, we will end up being one of the Hasirin, one of those who's lost? The language in this case, as in the others, is the case of a man painfully aware of his need of forgiveness for sin. And this man Durrani even overlaps his own points by saying that where the intention is good, but the judgment is in error, he is still said to merit a reward. In other words, that even though a man does a wrong thing, if he has a good intention, then he deserves a reward from God. As Jesus once said of Satan, you're a hindrance to me, he said. You are on the side of men and not on the side of God. And this man Durrani is the same. It is a typical human thought when men try to comfort themselves with their own petty self-righteousness, that as long as they have a good intention, doesn't matter how bad or how evil the thing is that they do, and this man even goes so far as to suggest you'll be rewarded, even though you do an evil thing. Now that is a very, very hard thing to tolerate, because then I would expect that Abraham would have been anticipating a reward, not seeking forgiveness for sin. Have you ever heard the expression, the road to hell is paved with good intentions? And that is just it, not the road to heaven. The road to heaven is paved with the works of those who do the will of God and who keep it. As Jesus said, not everyone who enters the kingdom of God are those who say, we have prophesied in your name, we have cast out demons in your name, we have done works in your name. No, Jesus said. Only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter the kingdom of God. You can bury your good intentions if they don't become practiced in good acts. Errors, mistakes before God are sins. And the Quran and the Bible have no misgiving about this. They treat them as such. And we can't follow the euphemistic line of reasoning of this man Durrani, who goes to most palpable lengths to try and excuse the prophets of their sins and makes the verses in the Quran say the opposite of what they are really saying. Now let's come to the prophet Moses. He's another one along the line. And we find that the Quran repeats the biblical incident of the killing of an Egyptian by Moses. Now Durrani claims that Surah 28:15 in fact absolves Moses from guilt, because although he struck the Egyptian, he did not intend to kill him, and therefore he did not sin, even though the Egyptian died. So I suppose he merited a reward, according to this man's strange line of reasoning. Well, I'd like to suggest that if you're driving down a road at a high speed, beyond the speed limit and you knock a man over unintentionally, you don't mean to kill the man, but you just happen to get in the way of your motor car while you weren't keeping a proper lookout, and you knock him over and you kill him, they'll go to court and try and use this argument when you are charged with culpable homicide. Try and reason that you didn't intend to kill the man, so you're not culpable. There's no way that you can be blamed for it. You never did anything wrong. The attitude of law, of man's law, universally throughout the world, is that you must foresee the consequences of your act, and that you are therefore responsible for such acts. Culpable homicide means to kill without intent. Murder means to intend to kill and to do the very thing. But when people kill others, even though they may not intend to do so, if they act in such a negligent way that their negligence causes the death of another man, that is a culpable offense, culpable homicide. And the offender is responsible for his act. And there is no indication in the verse to support the suggestion of Durrani that this man did not intend to kill the Egyptian. He struck him. And it won't help you if you strike somebody so hard that you kill him unintentionally. It won't help you to go to a court of law and say, I didn't mean to kill him, I was only trying to give him a good hammering. For all his efforts to acquit Moses, Durrani is contradicted by the Qur'an itself, which says in the very next verse after the one that we've been referring to, Moses said, My Lord, lo, I have wronged my soul, so forgive me. The word there, Taghfir, G-F-R again, same root letters. Then he forgave him. That means God forgave him. Lo, he is the forgiving and the merciful. Huwa khafuru rahim. He said, Moses, My Lord, for as much as thou hast favored me, I will never more be a supporter of the guilty. Which implies that he had been a supporter of the guilty. And the tone is so much the same as that of Adam when he disobeyed God. And we have here a clear picture of a man who has sinned and who is beseeching God not to punish him. In three words in that short passage, we find the root letters G-F-R in a word implying forgiveness. Moses says, forgive me, Taghfir. Then it says, he forgave him, Taghfir. And then it says, of Allah, Huwa Khafuru Rahim. He is the forgiving and the merciful. And there's only one thing that we can draw from that, and that is that Moses, like the others, was a man who had sinned against God and who needed forgiveness. And the next prophet that I come to in the Quran is the prophet Jonah, Yunus. And significantly, Durrani ignores this prophet altogether, because perhaps for all his feeble line of reasoning, and for all the strange efforts that he makes to get away from the plain teaching of the Qur'an, he found that he could not absolve this prophet from the plain statements in the Qur'an attributing sin to him. Surah 21 verse 87 reads, He went off in anger and deemed that we had no power over him. But he cried out in the darkness, saying, There is no God save thee. Be thou glorified. Lo, I have been a wrongdoer. 21:87. 37:142 says, The fish swallowed him while he was blameworthy. And so we see that Jonah in the Quran is a wrongdoer and one worthy of blame. And that is something which comes not out of our mouths, but out of the mouth of the Book of Islam. And I would like to refer to two Muslim authors who say the following about Jonah. One is a man called Muhajir in his book, Lessons from the Stories of the Quran. And he says, the lessons from Jonah's story are that God forgives sins on true repentance, whether they be in a righteous man or in a wicked people. And we can see quite clearly here that this man considers that what Jonah did was something that can only be described as a sin, and that although he was a righteous man, like any other man on earth, whether wicked or righteous, he needed forgiveness. And Shamim Raza, the book introducing the prophet, says, He lost patience and constancy, and invoked God's wrath upon the people, and in a fit of rage, left the place without waiting for further command. He imagined perhaps God had no power over him, for this indiscipline, he had to pay a very high price. That's what this man says. And to say after all that Jonah was without sin is to insult God to such extent that you make a mockery of his holy laws, and you imply that God looks on such blameworthy conduct unconcerned about the implications in respect of his holiness. One can no longer accept that such a man has sinlessness which is unassailable, as Durrani says. Otherwise, if that is the case, if a man can do so much as Jonah did, and if writers like these can describe his disobedience in such strong terms, how then can we ever believe that there's any distinction between good and evil if they remain sinless? Then we'd like to know, what is sin, and why is it sin for one man and not for another? But this brings me to the last point. Muhammad, the prophet of Islam. In the Quran, in Surah 47 and verse 19, we read these words. So know, in brackets, O Muhammad, there is no God save Allah, and ask forgiveness for thy sin. The words here, wastaghfir lidhanbika. Ask forgiveness comes from the usual root letter, GFR, lidhanbika, Quranic word meaning sin. By some fascinating verbal juggling, Muslim commentators like Durrani and others tried to imply that this does not mean that Muhammad was asking forgiveness for his own sins, even though that is what the text plainly states. And they say that he was asking, on one hand, in an obligatory capacity. This is the kind of reasoning used. They say he was not asking for forgiveness for himself. He was asking on behalf of his people. But that is nonsense, because it goes on to say, ask forgiveness for your own sin and for the sins of believing men and believing women. And Muhammad himself is distinguished in that passage from them. And why, if he was asking in an obligatory capacity on their behalf, why is he expressly commanded to ask forgiveness on his own behalf, if he had no sin to be forgiven of? We can't believe that God asks men to ask forgiveness for sins they never committed. It's ridiculous. And in fact, in Surah 48 and verse 2, this is the very next surah, we find certain words that shed more light on this and knock out this theory that he was asking in an obligatory capacity. The surah begins as follows. Verily we, a victory we have given you, a manifest victory, that he may forgive you of your sins, past and future, and may accomplish the more his favor on you, and may keep you guided on a straight path. The words here, liyaghfira, he may forgive you. And again the word, zambika, of your sins. And it is quite plain from the words that follow, past sins and future sins, that this he could hardly be said to be something that he was asking in an obligatory capacity. In fact, it is useful to note that one of the great commentators of the Quran in Islam, Badawi, says on this passage in his own commentary that these words, your past and your future sins, or your, as he puts it here, thy former and thy latter sins, not necessarily future, but your more recent sins, everything blameworthy that has proceeded from you, that's how Badawi comments on this particular passage. And therefore the plain import of the verses we are considering is that Muhammad had committed sins and that he was told to pray for forgiveness for them. To twist this into an official or obligatory capacity is to render the verse nonsensical. In that case, he's asked to pray for sins that he committed in the distant past and sins in the recent past that he never committed at all. And if he did so, if he asked forgiveness for sins that he hadn't committed, then he'd be committing a sin himself, because he'd be lying about things that he never did. And it becomes more and more obscure. The doctrine of the sinlessness of the prophets is something which is utterly contrary to Quranic teaching. The Quran. And while we are on this point about Muhammad, let us turn to the Hadiths, because they help to enlighten us all the more. If the Quran does not teach the sinlessness of the prophets, what does the Hadith say? Maybe in the Hadith we find this kind of teaching. Well, unfortunately, it's just the opposite. I'm quoting from the Mishkatul Masabi, of Fazlul Karim, page 786, he says in his work al-Hadith, that quoting from one of the major works of tradition in Islam, Abu al-Ajjar al-Anmari reported, when the Prophet of Allah went to bed at night, he said, in the name of Allah, I put down my side for Allah. O Allah, forgive my sins, remove my evil spirit, and relieve me from my secured loan, and make me join the highest assembly of angels. In other words, page 804, we find that his own wife, Aisha, reported that the Apostle of Allah used to say, O Allah, I seek refuge to thee from the evils of what I have done and the evils of what I have not done. And then again, page 809, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari reported from the Prophet that he used to supplicate with this supplication, O Allah, forgive my sins, ignorance, and extravagance in my affairs, and what thou knowest best about it from me, O Allah, forgive my earnestness and frivolity, my mistakes and intentions, and everything of what is with me. O Allah, forgive me of the sins I sent in advance and I will send in future, and what I kept secret, and what I disclosed, and what thou knowest about it better than myself. Thou art the first and thou art the last, and thou art powerful over all things. 2 pages on, O Lord, accept my repentance, wash off my sins. And H.E.W. Stanton, in his book, The Teaching of the Qur'an, says on page 51, in the Qur'an, Muhammad remains a fallible and sinful creature. The conception of him as the ideal man and prototype of humanity belongs to a later development. Another way of saying that the doctrine of the sinlessness of Muhammad and the other prophets is a product of popular sentiment and does not arise from an exposition of the teaching of the Quran, which is to the contrary. But to pass on at this stage to a more refreshing note, let me again quote this man, Shamim Raza. He says of Adam's disobedience to God, comfort was perhaps not written in the fate of Adam and his progeny. They were perhaps created to live by toil. When they were asked about their present shameless condition, they confessed that they were beguiled and outwitted, turned rebellious for a moment, forgot his kind grace and commandment, and broke the covenant. In other words, they had sinned. There was no sin in the state of nature. Sin came from the knowledge of it, from the fateful fruit of the tree of knowledge. When Adam hid behind the tree and hesitated to come before God in the nude, sin had been born. Page 5, those are the words. How simply this man puts it. His actual words are, in other words, they had sinned. How can any reasonable and sensible man conclude otherwise? And finally, to put this whole matter of Islamic teaching that all men are sinners into a conclusive nutshell, in the same context in which they are in the Bible, let me quote one more tradition from the Hadith. This is again from the Mishkatul Musabi, page 760 of Fazlul Karim's translation. Anas reported that the Apostle of Allah said, every son of Adam is a sinner, and the best of the sinners are those who repent constantly. The conclusion is so finely stated. Every son of Adam is a sinner. And from the authority of the Prophet of Islam himself, we shall conclude that this fact is henceforth common cause between Islam and Christianity. And if we must go further, before coming to Jesus Christ, in the Quran, Allah has a number of names. One of them, which we find in Surah 4110, but all over the book, it's used in a number of occasions, is al-Ghafur, and it means the forgiving, and it's invariably used in a context where forgiveness is being dealt with. Or in another case, Surah 38, verse 66, al-Ghaffar, which means very forgiving. And compare this verse 4110. It says, he who works an evil or wrongs his own soul and thereafter begs forgiveness of Allah will find Allah forgiving and merciful. And the words in Arabic here, that he who works an evil or wrongs his soul and yastaghfir, asks for forgiving or forgiveness from Allah, will find that Allah is Ghafura Rahima. He is the forgiving, the merciful. We find in Surah 5, verse 74, that where people are being reproved for committing one of the worst of sins according to the Qur'an, that is to associate partners with God, to equate other beings or other people with God, that is in Islam regarded as one of the worst of sins, they are said, it is said of them that they should yastaghfiruna, they should ask forgiveness. Afala yatubuna illallahi wa yastaghfiruna. Will they not turn to Allah and ask for forgiveness? And that's precisely the word used when the Quran says to Muhammad, you ask forgiveness for your sins. Yastaghfiruna. And just what can we conclude from this? That Muhammad was being told to do the very thing that people who equate partners with God were told to do. The word is the same. How can it mean one thing in one case and another thing in another? But this is what Muslims who are so determined to try and force this theory into the Quran, which they can't get out of it, they do precisely this. They say in Muhammad's case the word does not mean forgiveness. They say they've discovered today, 1300 odd years later, they have discovered that the word means protection and not forgiveness. But in Muhammad's case, yastaghfiruna means ask protection. But in the Christian's case, when you believe Christ is the Son of God, ask for forgiveness, although the word is the same. Now, how can you draw out a different interpretation? There's a vast distinction between protection and forgiveness. But we find in Surah 40 and verse 7, and here we are going to knock at this theory, because throughout the Quran we find that this theory cannot be sustained. Here we find teaching which shows quite clearly that to ask for protection is something distinct from asking for forgiveness. We find, firstly, that angels ask for forgiveness for believers. The words are, 40 verse 7, وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, which means, and forgive those who believe. But then it goes on, وَكُنِّهِمْ عَذَابَ الْجَحِيمِ, and that means to ask for protection from the fire. And the words there are different. The forgiveness is the word which appears in the earlier part of the verse, and its root word is GFR. But you don't find any word with the root GFR in the latter part of the verse, where the angels are asking for protection. There is only one word used for forgiveness in the Quran, and it is the word which always derives in its various forms from these three root letters, a ghayn, a fa, and a ra, G-F-R. And nowhere can we find in the Quran that you can possibly get the interpretation from the Quran that this means protection. Not even in the context of these passages where Muhammad is told to ask for forgiveness, or where the other prophets are told to ask for forgiveness, can you really, particularly where certain things they've done that are wrong are included, can you possibly draw this interpretation that they were asking protection? It is only when you come with this preconceived notion that the prophets could never have sinned, and you read that into the Quran, that you have to force a clear word like this, yastaghfiruna, which can only mean ask forgiveness. You twist the thing around completely, you violate its plain meaning, and you try to force it to yield the interpretation, ask protection. There's no way that a sincere expositor of the Quran, purely reading the book, can draw that interpretation out of the Quran. It can only be read into it. And furthermore, as I showed, how do you ask for protection for sins that have been committed in the past? As Muhammad was commanded to do in Surah 48 and verse 2, that Allah may forgive you of the dhambika that are past and that are to come. How do you ask for protection for something that is past? You ask for forgiveness for things that have passed. And I'll go one further. That if this word yastaghfiruna means ask protection, then when it says wallahu ghafuru rahim in the Quran, that must mean that Allah is the protector, the merciful. And we are then inclined to believe that there is no word in the Quran that means forgiveness. Because we must be consistent. We must give this word a consistent interpretation in every case. And if it means protection in one case, then it must mean protection throughout the book. Because in Arabic, any word that has three root letters always conveys the same meaning. And we would expect then that if Allah was the protector, he would be called al-Ghafur. but in the Qur'an we find there is another word describing Allah as the protector, and it appears in Surah 59 and verse 23, where Allah is called, among a whole lot of other names included there, al-Muhaymin, which means Allah the protector. And the word Ghafoor is invariably used with the word Rahim, forgiveness and mercy. Cannot mean protection. All men in the Qur'an, prophets of God included by nature, are sinners. The word Isma is never used in the Qur'an to describe the prophets of God. There is no direct teaching in the Qur'an that the prophets of God were sinners. But there is teaching in the Qur'an clearly that these prophets sinned against God, asked for forgiveness. And as I say, one can only violate the plain meaning of Arabic words to try and force a word like yastaghfiruna to yield anything else than the only meaning it can yield, and that is ask forgiveness. But I ask you at this stage, why do the Muslims then come across this idea that the prophets of God are sinners? If, as I say, the Quran so unambiguously teaches that the prophets of God were sinners like everyone else, and if the Hadith, as I've shown you, teaches that equally emphatically, and why do the Muslims come up with this doctrine that the prophets are sinners? Why can't they accept the Quranic teaching? Well, there must be a reason for that. And you'll find that the reason is a very obvious one when you study it carefully. Because Jesus Christ in Christianity is considered to be the only person who was sinless. And this implies that he was more than a prophet. In the Bible, all the prophets of God had sins of their own. The only one who was excluded was Jesus Christ, and he is described as sinless in the Bible, and that's why he is not just a prophet. He is the eternal Lord from heaven. Now the Quran, of course, will not allow that Jesus is distinguished from the other prophets, and in Surah 5, verse 75, it says, "Ma al-Masih ibn Maryam illa Rasul." Verily, the son of Mary, the Messiah, is only a messenger. And the Quran denies the deity of Jesus Christ, denies his crucifixion, and it tries to pull him down to the level of the other prophets. It says that the other prophets like him passed away before him. Qad khalat min qablihi rusul. And therefore, in issues like his deity, his redeeming work, other great works that Jesus did, the Quran ignores or denies these things to try and bring him into this context that he was only a prophet like the others. And from a Christian point of view, what the Quran is doing is to pull Jesus Christ down to the level of the other prophets. But, of course, in certain respects, you can't pull him down. And one of them is this question of sinlessness. You can't pull him down to their level and show that he sinned like them and he wronged his soul and he asked for forgiveness and all this, because he didn't. So what do? Very subtly, they try to raise the other prophets to his level. And that is what has brought about this doctrine of the sinlessness of the prophets. It's an effort to raise the other prophets up to the level of Jesus Christ. To say that if Jesus was no different to the prophets, if you can't prove that, well then you forge the thing a bit further. You say the other prophets were no different to him. If he was sinless, then they must have been sinless. And that's where you get this forged idea that the prophets of God were sinless. And the real problem is that Jesus Christ, as in the Bible, is described in the Quran as sinless. He is the only person so described. The others are not so described. Isma is not used for the prophets in the Quran. There's no teaching in the Quran that the prophets were without sin. No dogmatic, unambiguous teaching to that effect. But there is such dogmatic, unambiguous teaching in the case of Jesus Christ. And we turn to Surah 19 and verse 19. Where it says in Arabic, the angel said to Mary, Qala innama ana rasul rabbik. That means, truly I am the messenger of your Lord. And then it says, li'ahhabalaki khulaman zakiyya. To bestow on you a khulam, a little boy, zakiyya. And what does this word mean? If you look through the translators of the Quran, you'll find that the word always holds one context. Sinless. Muhammad Ali says in his translation, pure. Others say, holy. The most accurate translator of the Quran into English, Mulana Daryabadi, he gets close to the right word. He says faultless. He's getting very close. the actual interpretation of this word zakiyya in the Quranic context, the best interpretation that can possibly be placed on this word is blameless. Contrary to what the Quran says of Jonah and others, that they were blameworthy. Because there's only one other occasion in the whole of the Quran where this word is used. And from the context, we can see what it means. And it's in Surah 18 and verse 74. Moses was working along with his page, and they journeyed, it says, until they met a boy, and his page killed him. Moses said to his page, "Have you killed an innocent person, not in return for someone else?" Moses was saying, "This little person here never did anything wrong against you or against anyone particularly in a context that you should kill him. He didn't commit a crime." And the word here is zakiyyata. Have you killed a zakiyyata? An innocent person, a blameless person, a person who has not committed a crime, did not do anything worthy of death. Now most of us in that respect perhaps are zakiyyata. We have not committed a crime worthy of death. We are blameless of any capital offense. And so we see a limited context of the word here. It means to be blameless of a heinous crime. But in the case of Jesus Christ, we find that it does not say Jesus was blameless of any crime, worthy of death, but that the angel comes to him and says, "I come to give you a zakiyya khula," using our words, a holy son, a blameless son. And that the angel says, "This is why I'm coming to you. This is why you're going to have this virgin birth. This is why I appear to you in this remarkable way. This is why you're going to have a unique birth, and this is why you have a remarkable vision. Because you are going to have a unique son and a remarkable son. That is why. You're having a strange vision, a strange experience. Something very special is going to come from your womb, something which the Quran itself says came from no other woman's womb. A khulam an zakiyya, a blameless son. Holy, sinless, pure." And the Quran admits this. You see, it is derived from Luke 1:35, where much the same is said in the Bible. The angel came to Mary and said, "The child to be born of you will be called holy, the Son of God." You see, this is the whole point. This concept that the child will be sinless and perfect is only consistent with a Christian doctrine that he was not a prophet like the other prophets who were full of sin, but that he was holy, perfect, pure and sinless because he was the eternal Son of God. And that, of course, Muslims don't want to admit. And so they fabricate this doctrine of Isma, sinlessness of the prophets, which is contrary to the teaching of the Quran and the Hadith. And I'll even go one further to back this up. The Hadith teaches that Jesus Christ was sinless in a manner distinct from all the other prophets and all the other men who've ever walked on this earth. In the Sahih of Bukhari, volume 4, page 427, we read these words. Narrated Sa'id bin al-Musayyab, Abu Huraira said, "I heard Allah the Prophet say, there is none born among the offspring of Adam, but Satan touches it. A child therefore cries loudly at the time of birth because of the touch of Satan, except Maryam and her child." Every child, according to the Hadith, according to Muhammad himself, every child is pricked by Satan at his birth, except the Son of Mary, Jesus Christ. And that backs up that teaching in the Quran, that Jesus is totally free from Satan's influence, totally without blame, totally sinless, in a way that none of the other prophets were. And what now do we conclude from this? We can only say that Jesus Christ, in the Quran and the Bible, is free of sin. And of course the Muslims don't want to accept that, because if they do, then it means he's head and shoulders above the others. But do you know that even in early works of Islamic tradition, before the implications of this were really understood, it was taught that Jesus was the sinless prophet of Islam? Unfortunately, there's no such thing as a sinless prophet. The Muslims began to realize that a sinless prophet must be a lot more than a prophet. So they try to raise up the other prophets to the level of sinlessness instead of raising Jesus to the glory that he deserves. What a shame. But truth is all that matters to us. They may be scared to concede things to Christianity, but we're only concerned about getting the truth of the matter out. And fortunately, we don't have to do what the Muslims do. Muslims go out of their way to have to twist a word like yastaghfiruna, and they try to make it say that Muhammad asked protection, even though every Muslim knows that that word means to ask forgiveness. We don't have to do this with Jesus Christ, because neither in the Quran nor the Bible do we ever find that Jesus Christ was told yastaghfiruna for thambika, ask forgiveness for your sins. 1 Peter 2 verse 22 says, he committed no sin. No guile was found on his lips. 1 John 3, 5, you know that he appeared to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. 2 Corinthians 5, 21, for our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Hebrews 4, 15, one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sinning. John 8, 46, Jesus said, which of you convicts me of sin? Fortunately, we don't have to twist our book to yield doctrines that are the opposite of what the book teaches. The Bible teaches plainly that Jesus Christ was without sin, as you can see from those words. The Quran teaches plainly that Jesus Christ was sinless. Both books only describe Jesus Christ as sinless. No other prophet of God in the Quran is described as zakiyya. In other words, sinless, blameless, pure, holy. But the Muslims have to fabricate this doctrine of the sinless of the other prophets to try and bring them up to the level of Jesus Christ. And that alone explains the origin of this peculiar anti-Quranic doctrine. It is a shameless attempt to avoid the evidence in favor of Jesus Christ as the sum total of all human perfection. The Muslims don't like to believe that, and so they try to twist the book, that we will allow the book to speak for itself. Nowhere in the Quran does Allah say to Jesus, yastaghfiruna, but he does to Muhammad and other prophets. And that can only lead to one conclusion, that Muhammad, as he composed the Quran, knew himself that Jesus Christ was sinless and that he was not. And in the Hadith you'll find that some of his closest followers, his own wife for one, were able to record prayers that he made where he detailed the sins that he believed he needed forgiveness for. The return of Jesus Christ alive to heaven in his own body is conceded in Islam. And that Jesus went up to heaven alive, right into the very holy presence of God, whereas all other prophets returned to the dust. This contrast speaks for itself again about Jesus Christ's transcendent glory, the sinfulness of other men. He alone as a human being could rise off the earth and go into the presence of God, because he alone was sinless. Another reason why the doctrine of the sinlessness of all the prophets has gained currency is that if it is conceded that Jesus Christ alone was sinless, then Adam and all his offspring were sinners, and therefore the Christian doctrine of original sin must be true, and therefore the need of the atoning work of Jesus Christ becomes fairly obvious as well. For the essence of this doctrine and the relationship of the one sinless man, Jesus Christ, to it is summed up in these words of Paul: as by one man's disobedience, that is Adam, many were made sinners, so by one man's obedience, that is Jesus Christ, many will be made righteous. That's Romans 5 verse 19 and 1 Corinthians 15, 22 here, or as Paul puts it, as in Adam all die, so in Christ shall all be made alive. And we can only conclude that the Isma doctrine is the product of popular sentiment. And they say that necessity is the mother of invention. And when you need to try and prove that Jesus was no more than the other prophets, you have to invent a doctrine like this of Isma. But the evidence from the Quran and the Hadith and from the Bible shows quite plainly that there was only one sinless man, so described in both books, who ever lived on the earth, and that was Jesus Christ. And that in both books, men who were regarded as prophets of God, other than Jesus Christ, are shown to be men of typical human failings, desperately in need of God's forgiveness. And therefore we can only conclude that this Islamic doctrine of Isma, of sinlessness of the prophet, is not one which is backed up by the Quran, and therefore one which cannot really be entertained seriously, and one which, from every point of view, Christian, objective or otherwise, must be rejected.
Hello, I'm Larry Wessels, Director of Christian Answers, and I want to thank you for being with us today on this program. Our show, Christian Answers, usually deals with different theological topics and comparative religions. And today we're dealing with an interesting subject on the religion of Islam. The title of our series that we're doing right now is called Answering Islamic Apologists. Now, Islamic apologists are guys that are arguing for the reasons why their religion is true, and basically other religions aren't true. And they're trying to give you reasons why their religion is superior to other religions, and they're at the same time trying to say how their religion is true, and they try to defend against attacks against their religion. And so we're going to deal here on Christian Answers with this particular topic today. We're dealing with Islamic apologists. I am basically keying this whole series on this set of tapes. There's several of them. I've already shown in show number one. We've got album after album of these tapes by Dr. Jamal Badawi of the Islamic Information Center out of Canada. And we're dealing with his arguments and tapes. We do have some other Islamic apologists as well we'll be dealing with in this series. But we're trying to analyze what they say and then also argue from a Christian perspective. And we're going to see where the truth lies. Because after all, in the end, it's truth that matters, not just what I say or this guy over here says or whatever. It's the truth, and that's what we're trying to get at. And in this program, I'm joined by a very special guest of mine, our director of research, Steve Morrison. Great to have you here, Steve.
Well, thank you, Larry.
And we've already done one show on Dr. Badawi, and we're getting ready to move on into the second show, dealing with his apologetics on why Islam is true, basically why Christianity is false. Mm-hmm. And we as representatives of the Christian point of view are going to try to, you know, answer some of these arguments by Dr. Badawi from his Islamic perspective and hopefully for the benefit of our viewers, either Muslim or Christians. We are not against, we don't hate Muslims. We don't hate Hindus. We don't hate anybody out there. We want to share the love of Christ with all fellows because that's what Jesus said to do, to love our fellow man. So we do this in a spirit of love, not of hate. And of course, also because we love Christ, it kind of hurts us in the heart when there's other people out there, particularly of other religious persuasions, that are attacking him as we perceive it, attacking Christ and what he stands for. And so we feel like it's our Christian duty to answer those arguments. And in fact, we're told to do that in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. Give to every man an answer for the hope that lies within you. Mm-hmm. It says in Titus 1:9 to refute those who contradict and have, a different doctrine. Throughout the scriptures, it says that we're to, come boldly and stand for Christ, not be ashamed of Christ, but stand up for Christ and rebuke, exhort, and correct those who would come with other ideas and doctrines. And so actually we're following the biblical command in this particular series dealing with Islamic apologists. So with that said, I'd like to mention that this is show number 2, and in our last show we left off with tape number 5, or actually tape number 6 in Badawi's series, is his first tape set we're dealing with. But we left a couple of loose ends. We're going to clean those up now and then continue to move through his tapes. In the last show, we were on his tape 5. He had mentioned the sinlessness of the prophets and how he didn't like what the Bible said about Abraham and Adam and Moses and some of the other Bible characters. He didn't like what the Bible said about them, Solomon's, and so forth, because it mentions some of their sins, some of their failings. And Badawi is saying that, these prophets of God, they don't sin like that. They lead good, excellent lives. They may have little tiny little problems, but nothing major like the Bible reports. And so he's basically saying all the Bible stories about Abraham and Moses and Solomon and so forth were wrong because they showed the sins of these particular biblical characters. And so what we're going to do is, in this particular program, is deal with the sinlessness of the prophets of Islam. In Islam, they think all these prophets, either if it's Adam or if it's Solomon or Moses, they didn't commit any real big sins or anything.
They didn't commit any sins at all.
Right,
they're sinless. According to modern Muslim teaching, yeah.
Well, basically, what I got from Badawi's teachings there. He mentions there might be some sins of omission and commission that are so minor as to be almost not even be considered sins. Because he said the only really sinless one is Allah. So as human beings, we have our frailties and our little problems. But as far as these kind of sins mentioned in the Bible, no way. He says they're like sinless in that sense. So he has a definition of sinlessness that doesn't actually mean sinlessness like a Christian would look at it in the life of Christ, as being totally without sin. His idea of sinlessness is more in a sense of sinlessness where they don't really commit any major sins, but there might be some tiny little things that are so minuscule as to almost not be noticed.
Kind of a modified or toned down sinlessness, right, or near sinlessness.
And that's why he can, because he affirms in his tapes over and over again that Jesus was not sinlessly perfect. He was just like the other sinless prophets of the Bible. And then he would work himself to bring Jesus down to that level of these other prophets of their sinlessness. But what we're going to do here to start this show is look into this whole idea of the sinlessness of the prophets of Islam. And if our viewers are watching, and I'm going to let Steve jump in wherever he wants to, I'm going to just get into this right away here and have you look for yourselves and analyze this. You'll see on your screen different things coming up as I talk about it. But let's start with some of these prophets of Islam. You know, the Muslims have 124,000 prophets. And of these prophets, there's some that are greater prophets than other prophets. But one of their great prophets is Adam. And what does it say about Adam in the Quran? We're going to go to the Islamic sources and see for ourselves what we're looking at here. We'll also get into what the Bible talks about these prophets as well. But what we get from the Muslim apologists, such as Dr. Badawi, is that these prophets, like Adam and these others we're going to give you, didn't really commit any sins. They're like sinless, but they might have had some little problems. But as far as they're concerned, these guys are basically sinless. Not maybe sinlessly perfect, but they're sinless in some sort of sense that they're trying to argue for. And so let's look at Adam in the Quran. And if you see on your screen there, we have Surah chapter 20, verses 120 and 121. What does it say? It says, "But Satan whispered evil to him," talking about Adam, and you'll see that right away. He said, this is Satan talking to Adam, "O Adam, in the result, they both ate of the tree. Thus did Adam disobey," period. That's in the Quran, and that's Surah 20, 120, and 121. Then we look at another Quranic verse. That's Surah 2, 26. And here it says that it is truth from their Lord. But those who reject faith say, "What means God by this similitude? By it he causes many to stray, and many he leads into the right path. But he causes not to stray, except those who forsake the path." And you have to, when you look at that, you kind of wonder, was Adam forgetful up here in that last verse we looked at? Or did Adam forsake the path that God had given him when it came to the things of the tree in the Garden of Eden? Now let's look at this next surah. Surah 7, 19 through 23. It says, "Adam," and then there's an ellipsis, "approach not this tree, or ye run into harm and transgression. So by deceit he," that would be talking about Satan, "brought about their fall. Their shame became manifest, and they said," that would be Adam and Eve, "we have wronged our own souls," end quote. And if you need a cross-reference to that, in the Al-Bukhari Hadiths, volume 6, verse 3, it says, "Adam will remember his sin," period. Just wanted to get a little stress on that. Adam will remember his sin. Now, let me turn to my brother here. He's been sitting patiently. The viewers at home just read all these for themselves on the screen. What does this look like from these Quranic texts and a little backup from the Hadith?
All right, well, it looks like that Adam sinned. And so if you say he's sinless, but he sinned, then it looks like Badawi, on the surface, you'd think he doesn't believe the Quran.
That's right.
Because the Quran says, and let's say you have a Muslim who hasn't read the Hadith and hasn't read the Quran. It's like, well, he could figure this out. It's not that difficult. If mankind fell, you know, with Adam and Eve, then and if they if you define Adam and Eve as a prophet, which well Adam is a prophet, which Islam mentions him as a prophet, then it's like, okay, well then prophets have to sin. Otherwise, everybody must be sinlessly perfect because man never fell.
Right. And like I said before, Badawi goes through a lot of trouble to try to say the sinlessness of his prophets doesn't actually mean total, complete, perfect sinlessness. He goes into this sense of sinlessness. But as we can see here, even by that definition, it looks clearly from the Islamic sources that Adam was a sinner. And how you can say he's sinless and he has a sinlessness, just no matter how you want to define that term, it doesn't work. Is all I'm saying. I'm just looking at this logically. I mean, just look. It's just he sinned. He disobeyed. He shamed his own soul. How obvious can he get? Now let's go to the next Bible prophet, or Islamic prophet, as they like to say. Going to the Quran on Noah. What about Noah? He's considered another great prophet of Islam, and one of these sinless prophets that the Muslim apologists talk about. Well, in Surah 11, verses 45 through 47, it says, Noah called upon his Lord and said, O my Lord, surely my son is of my family. And then there's an ellipsis. He said, O Noah, he is not of thy family, for his conduct is unrighteous. So ask not of me. Noah said, O my Lord, I do seek refuge with thee, lest I ask thee for that of which I have no knowledge, and unless thou forgive me and have mercy on me, I should indeed be lost. Okay, now it's still on the screen there, folks. You're looking right at it. Now, I want you to notice right down there at the bottom. See, Noah says, forgive me and have mercy on me, I should indeed be lost. But why is he saying that? If you keep looking at it, it goes back up there. It's because Noah's asking, if you see in this passage, he's asking that his son get a break, basically. But then God says, no, he's not going to get a break because his conduct is unrighteous. And you shouldn't be asking for this. And then Noah realizes his mistake, that he shouldn't have asked God to give his son a break. And then he's so worried about it, he says, forgive me for this. I've blown it. I shouldn't have done this. Have mercy on me. Or else, you know, I'll be lost if you don't forgive me for this. I'll be lost. I mean, to me, once again, let me get my brother in here on this. Once again, it looks like a prophet of Islam has blown it.
Yep. Muslims as well as Christians would agree that Noah was a prophet, and if Noah wasn't sinless, and therefore all the prophets are not sinless, and then therefore there's no reason for saying if Muhammad was sinless, since there's no statement in the Quran. See, since there's no statement that says specifically Muhammad was sinless, the only hope they have to support him being sinless is by saying all the prophets were.
Right.
So even a prophet like Noah basically blows out of the water.
So basically what you're saying, this whole idea that the Muslim apologists come up with, that all the prophets are sinless, is simply a ploy to try to bring their prophets, including Muhammad, up to the level of Jesus.
That's right.
Who they know was sinless from all accounts. And we'll get into that in a little while. Okay, let's go back to our screen here into the Quran. And as you're looking on at home, you can see now we're going to talk about Moses. And we're looking in the Quran. And we're looking at Surah 28, verses 15 and 16. Quoting, Moses struck him with his fist and made an end of him. He said, this is a work of evil, in parentheses from the Yusuf Ali translation, Satan. And then he says, ellipsis, he prayed, O my Lord, I have indeed wronged my soul. This is Moses talking. Do thou then forgive me? He asks a question. And then it goes on to say, so God forgave him. So what we have here is a story about Moses. He strikes this Egyptian and he kills him. And now he's all worried about killing this guy. And he asks God, indeed I've wronged my soul for killing this guy. Will you forgive me for it? Steve, it just looks like he's asking forgiveness. He feels like he's done something wrong.
Mm-hmm.
He has sinned. And he's asking God to forgive him for this sin.
Right. And what the Quran says about Moses killing an Egyptian, this is prior to leading the Israelites out of Egypt, is actually very similar to what the Bible says. And of course, Moses was in the wilderness in Midian, hiding from Pharaoh, basically, you know, for 40 years after that. But he did something wrong. And it's like, okay, so if you say he's sinless, but he still does things wrong, then you've basically gutted the definition of the word sinless.
Exactly, exactly. Keep that in mind, folks. Okay, let's go to our next prophet of Islam, one of these sinless prophets that the Muslims are always talking about, Jonah. Or in the Quranic text, it'd be Zunun, I guess would be the proper pronunciation. Okay, Surah 21:87. The Quran says, "And remember Zunun, when he departed in wrath, he cried through the depths of darkness, 'There is no God but thou. Glory to thee. I was indeed wrong.'" Now let's go right away to the next surah in the Quran, which also ties in with Jonah, or Zunun in this case. Verse 37:142, it says, "Then the big fish did swallow him, and he had done acts worthy of blame," end quote. Okay, so the viewers there can see for themselves, Jonah admits he was indeed wrong. I was indeed wrong. And then in another part in the Quran, it says that Jonah had done acts worthy of blame. Now, to me, that looks perfectly clear, like he sinned. Jonah sinned, according to the Quran. And yet, the Muslims today, and these Muslim apologists like Dr. Badawi, I'm sure, and these other people, they say he's a sinless prophet. And he's just as sinless as Jesus or any of the rest of them. Steve, any comment, or should I go on?
Well, I was trying to see how Yusuf Ali, in his footnotes, how he would handle this. And he basically has no problem with it at all. After mentioning there are some huge fishes, and he thinks, you know, mentions crocodile and huge fish in the Tigris River, which I don't believe that, but that's his view. And it says in his footnote, 41:25, it says, "This was to be the burial and grave of Jonah inside the big fish. If he had not repented, he could not have gotten out of the body of the creature that had swallowed him until the day of the resurrection, when all the dead would be raised up." So Yusuf Ali, who is not holding to the sinlessness of Jonah in this case, said that he had to repent. So are you sinless, but you still got to repent? You know, again, that's just eviscerating the idea of sinless.
And it destroys the whole idea. What is sinless? If this isn't a sin, or any of these guys we've mentioned so far are not sinning, then what is sin? You know.
Right.
Okay, let's go on to our next prophet of Islam. Now, this one's a big one. This is a really big prophet of Islam. In fact, the over there in Mecca at the Kaaba, they've got all these shrines and rituals dedicated to Abraham, the prophet Abraham. So let's see what the Quran says about the prophet Abraham. Surah 26:82. It says, Abraham speaking, "And who, I hope, will forgive me my faults on the day of judgment," end quote. Here you have it. You're looking at it on your screen, folks. You can see it right there. This is Abraham talking in the Quran, and he's talking to God, talking about God, "Who, I hope, will forgive me my faults." He couldn't really be talking to anybody else. He's got to be talking about God, and he's got to be talking to God about his faults. And faults, obviously, are sins, because if they weren't really sins, why do you need to ask forgiveness for them? You know, what do you have to say about that, Steve? To me, it looks like a fault is a sin, and to say it's something else wouldn't make any sense.
Right. John Gilchrist, in some of his tapes, he has a tape on the sinlessness of, or sinfulness of, the prophets and Muhammad, and the sinlessness of Christ, and some of this material, you know, came from there. He basically shows that there, the Arab cognate, the consonants used in this word, and of course the Quran was written with just consonants originally, the only place that it's used, it refers to something having to do with a sin or something wrong. So you could say this word translated fault, it, you know, could be fault, sin, transgression. That, you know, there might be some variation there, but regardless, it's something that needs forgiving for.
Right.
And so to say, well, I don't have sins, I just have a lot of stuff that needs forgiving for. It's like, well, then why are you just playing with words? You know.
because it guts the meaning
right.
of the words themselves and blows out the context of what the Quran's telling us.
Because mm-hmm.
if you can make faults or asking for forgiveness into anything else that's not really a sin, and then you don't really need forgiveness for it. Because
right.
if it's not a sin, why do you need forgiveness? It would be a sin then to ask for forgiveness for something that's not needing forgiveness for.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't win either way going this route. Okay, let's go to another prophet of Islam. You may have heard of this one, Muhammad. What about Muhammad? I think he's known in the Islamic world as a prophet. Was prophet just as sinless as Jesus, as they say? Well, let's take a look in the Quran. Surah 48, verses 1 and 2. It says, "Lo, we have given thee, O Muhammad, signal victory, that Allah may forgive thee of thy sin, that which is past and that which is to come, and may perfect his favor unto thee and guide thee on the right path," end quote. Now, I don't know about you, but just keep looking at it on your screen there. It says that Allah may forgive thee of thy sin, basically your past, present, and future sins, as you go on in that text. He wants forgiveness for all these sins, and I think that's clear enough. But now there may be Muslim apologists would argue, no, I don't mean that. But anyway, let's go on to another Quranic text and see if we can get some real context to all this. Surah 40, 55. "Patiently then, persevere, for the promise of God is true, and ask forgiveness for thy fault." So here we go again, Steve. We got a fault of the prophet here mentioned in that next Surah 40, verse 55, about Muhammad.
All right. I once asked a Muslim about 40:55, and what he said is that he thought that word shouldn't be fault, but it should be frailty.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So let's follow that path for a second. All right. So if Allah made somebody frail, maybe, you know, you're frail physically, or you tire easily, or you have some physical sickness, or there's something that's frail about your physical or emotional whatever makeup. So, but it's not a sin. It's not something you had responsibility for, not something that you did wrong. Then you're asking forgiveness for how Allah made you? That path seems to go into a blind end there.
That's right.
So whatever you say about that word, that's something that we need forgiveness for. Now, we need forgiveness for things that we're responsible for. Now, of course, not just things we do, but good things that we fail to do, as well as say, and as well attitudes of our heart. But Muhammad needed forgiveness.
That's right.
And Jesus needed no forgiveness.
Now, I'm sure there's still Muslims out there who would disagree with this, but what's interesting, too, and I've got a Yusuf Ali translation right here with me, 1977 edition. But a footnote to that surah there, Ali, in his translation and commentary, says on page 1277, footnote 4428, says, "Every mortal, according to his nature and degree of spiritual enlightenment, falls short of the perfect standard of God." And he also references that point to Surah 1661. "And should therefore ask God for forgiveness." So he's already saying every mortal,
right,
of which Muhammad would be one, you know, falls short of the perfect standard of God. And then we also can look at Surah 18:110, which says Muhammad was just a mortal man. And he says, Muhammad there in Surah 18 says, I am a man like yourselves. I am but a man like yourselves.
Okay.
So we know Muhammad's mortal according to the Quran. And here's this Muslim commentator kind of goes along with this point about how even Muhammad, being a mortal, falls short of the standard of God and has to seek forgiveness. Now, if that's not enough, there'll still be Muslims that won't accept even a Muslim commentator.
Mm-hmm.
What about the Hadiths? Now, of course, I know the Shiites probably won't pay much attention, so they're just stuck with all these references we gave from the Quran, which I think are positive proof. But if you need more, let's go to the Hadiths. So maybe you have some reliability on, like, the al-Bukhari Hadith. Well, in al-Bukhari Hadith, volume 1, 19, it says, "O Allah's apostle, we are not like you. Allah has forgiven your past and future sins," end quote. He's forget, and it says right there, sins,
mm-hmm.
S-I-N-S. He has forgiven your past and future sins. And I don't think there's any way out of that one. Now let's look at the next one. Bukhari Hadith, Volume 1, 744, or 711. O Allah, set me apart from my sins. In parentheses, it says faults. So now we have the Hadith verifying that a fault is a sin, like we mentioned before. Okay. He says, cleanse me from my sins. This is Muhammad talking. He says, wash off my sins. So you've got basically, set me apart from my sins, cleanse me from my sins, wash off my sins. So Muhammad apparently thinks he's got sins. Bukhari Hadith, Volume 1, 781. O Allah, forgive me. Bukhari Hadith, Volume 8, 319. Narrated Aku Herrera. I heard Allah's apostle saying, by Allah, I ask for Allah's forgiveness and turn to him to repentance more than 70 times a day. So 70 times a day, Muhammad had to ask for forgiveness. If you remember Yusuf Ali's narration a minute ago, he's asking for forgiveness of sins because he falls short of the standard of God. So that's actually, he must have been committing quite a few sins to be committing 70 sins a day. But anyway.
Yeah. Just think, how many times, no, he asked forgiveness.
Forgiveness, 70 times a day.
So how many times is that an hour divided by 24?
Well, that's right. So that's like, quite a bit. So he must have really felt guilty.
Yeah. I mean, of course, he probably, we don't know if he did when he was sleeping or not, but so it's like, he must have spent all his time doing that. How did he have time to conquer anywhere?
That's a good point. But that's what it says in the Al-Bukhari Hadith 8:319, but also in that same volume, 8:407, it says, forgive me my sins, forgive my mistakes, those done intentionally or out of ignorance or with seriousness. Forgive my sins of the past and of the future, which I did openly or secretly.
Okay.
And that's Muhammad again. And he's readily admitting that he's either done open sins or he's done secret sins, and either intentional sins, he's admitting he's done that, mm-hmm. or whatever. But I don't know how much more of a confession you need to see that this guy is saying, I'm a sinner. Yeah. I am a sinner, and I need forgiveness. And you can also see in the Musa, that's another hadith. How do you pronounce that, Steve? Ashari?
Ashari, yeah.
Ashari. Musa Ashari, page 809. Muhammad was a sinner, and on page 768, every son of Adam is a sinner. So on another hadith, we have those statements right there. So I think it's pretty clear from Islamic teaching mm-hmm. and Quranic teaching that Muhammad was a sinner.
Now it's a curious little phrase there. Every son of Adam is a sinner. All right, well, Muslims, the Quran does show that Jesus was not a sinner, but the Quran also establishes that Jesus was born of a virgin. So in that sense, he's not a son of Adam, you know, at least on his father's side. But Muhammad, Christians and Muslims agree, he was born, you know, in the normal manner of things. And so if every son of Adam's a sinner, then Muhammad's a sinner too.
That's right. But I think Muhammad is worthy to be believed here. He spent so much time talking about being a sinner and asking for forgiveness. I think we can believe Muhammad in his hadith when he says he was a sinner and he had to ask forgiveness 70 times a day. And it's also an interesting note here that many people may not realize that, you know, whenever you tell lies, the problem with a lie is that because it doesn't fit with reality and it doesn't fit with the truth, you always have to kind of bend over backwards to try to make that lie look plausible.
And it grows.
Lies are really hard to substantiate when reality and truth, you know, stick up their ugly heads and make that lie look what it really is. Well, what I found Muslim apologists try to do, especially when they're confronted with these unfortunate hadiths and Quranic verses, is they try to say, well, they can't deal with the sin part too much, so they're going to try to go with the forgiveness of sins. And they try to say, that word forgiveness doesn't really mean forgiveness of sins. What it really means is protection. And this is a big Islamic argument that when they're asking for forgiveness, they're not really asking for forgiveness of sins. They're asking for protection from God.
So they're making their argument that that's what forgiveness means. Okay.
Right. That's exactly what they argue. But when you...
You know what that reminds me of? Is there are some Sufi groups that when they read the Quran, there are certain words that they believe have a little different meaning than, I guess, most Arabs would commonly think and the Sunnis would believe. And so it's like they just put their own meanings in.
Right.
And Christian cults, by the way, they sometimes do the same to the Bible. So it's not unique to Islam. But
do you see the problem? When you're telling a lie and you're trying to get out of something, you have to go to extreme lengths that really aren't plausible, because a lie just doesn't hold up when you analyze it with the truth. And to say that the word protection is what really is meant in all these Quranic verses and things that say forgiveness is in itself a lie, I would argue, because they're just trying to escape the truth of the sinlessness, that the sinlessness of the prophets of Islam is not true. And when you look at Surah 40, verse 7, it refutes a contention, that contention right there from the Arabic. And I ask anyone that knows Arabic to check out Surah verse 40, verse 7, because you have differing words in Arabic, some that mean forgiveness and some that mean protection. So even in the very language, you have a difference in role and meanings by the different words used in the Arabic. The Arabic language itself does not allow for this interpretation of protection. How do you ask for protection from sins committed in the past? Like Surah 48:2 says, as Muhammad is asking for in that we already read. So if it means protection, how can Muhammad ask for something that was committed in the past for protection from something that's already happened?
Right.
It doesn't make any sense.
And Surah 47, in Yusuf Ali's translation in English, he has forgiveness, and then later on down he says, forgive then those who turn in repentance. So I would say, okay, so it's protection for those who turn in repentance. Well, then basically there is no word forgiveness if you're going with that argument, because what do you do when you turn in repentance? You know, if Allah gives you whatever that is, that's what we're talking about.
That's right. And another problem that they have using this argument is in Surah 59, verse 23, one of the names of Allah is protector. And once again, I point you to the Arabic language and the plain meaning of the language. There's no way they can argue this point about forgiveness meaning protection, because those are different Arabic words.
A forgiver, if I remember right, is also another name of Allah. So it's like, so you mean those two names are really only one name?
You know. Exactly. And it's like I said, a truth under a lie under the microscope of truth just doesn't hold up. Mm-hmm. And now it may seem plausible if no one wants to check into it, but I hope from this presentation that no one will make that mistake. I think what we're finding here is Muslim apologists willingly and knowingly try to escape what the Quran and the Hadiths clearly teach. Mm-hmm. Because the bottom line is they're trying to escape the fact that Muhammad was a sinner, and so were all these other prophets, and Jesus is way above that, which would make Jesus superior to Muhammad. And that's the whole reason they come up with this stuff about the sinlessness of the prophets, to escape the impact of Jesus being the sinless prophet, which will automatically make him superior to Muhammad or anyone else. So anyway, let's go on in this study. The Quran says Jesus was blameless, pure, holy, and faultless, according to the Arabic language.
And we agree with
that.
And
how do we know that? Yeah. Now, how do we know that? Well, here it is on the screen. Surah 19:19. It says, he said, nay, I am only a messenger from thy Lord to announce to thee the gift of a holy son. This is talking about the Virgin Mary, and she's going to have a holy son. And when you look at that Arabic word there, its meaning translates from the Arabic either to blameless, pure, holy, or faultless. But the purest meaning of it, and it depends on your different translators from the Arabic, is blameless.
Yeah, Yusuf Ali says pure, but still right. That's pretty close.
But still, you're getting the idea here. So here's a son that's born. As he's born, he's already holy, or pure, or blameless, or faultless. Okay, we look in the next point. The word here for holy is used in only one other place in the Quran, and that is in Surah 18:74, where Moses says, hast thou slain an innocent person? Notice the word innocent. In context, the word for innocent means blameless, or not committed a crime, end quote. Likewise, the meaning is the same of Jesus in Surah 19:19. Let's go to the Hadith. Sahih al-Bukhari, volume 4, 506 says, narrated Abu Huraira, The prophet said, when any human being is born, Satan touches him at both sides of the body with his two fingers, except Jesus, the son of Mary, whom Satan tried to touch but failed, for he touched the placenta instead. End quote. So here's the devil. He's able to touch all these people, but he wasn't able to touch Jesus at all. The closest he got was a placenta, but that's still not Jesus. And then we go on in the Al-Bukhari Hadith, volume 4, 641. It says, and you can see it on your screen at home, I heard Allah's apostle saying, there is none born among the offspring of Adam, but Satan touches it. A child, therefore, cries loudly at the time of birth because of the touch of Satan, except Mary and her child.
Mary and her child.
Right. Oh. So the devil, here's why, you know, he's saying the reason children cry when they're born is because they're being touched by the devil. But here, the only exception to this rule is Mary and her child. The child, Jesus, was not touched. And by deduction, you can figure he didn't cry either.
Right.
But here, the devil couldn't touch him.
Right. Now some Muslims say that not only was Jesus sinless, but Mary was sinless also, because, you know, how could a sinless prophet come from a sinful woman? Like, okay, well, if that's true, then how could a sinless person like Mary come from a sinful mother? So it's like, then her mother have to be sinless, and everybody have to be sinless all the way back to Eve. So that argument, that, you know, doesn't hold up.
That's right. That's right. And also, another thing that people have to realize is that the early Muslim writers, as Steve's documented a lot of our video shows on Islam in the past, you have early Muslim biographers, early Muslim writers that live closer to the time of Muhammad than these modern writers and apologists do today. But even in early Muslim writings, they testified to the sinlessness of Jesus.
Right.
And this is in actual Muslim writings, not Christian writings.
And as far as I'm aware, all Muslims agree that Jesus is sinless, with the exception of, in Answering Islam, says that the Ahmadiyya say that he's not sinless. But
right. So it's this idea that Dr. Badawi and these other people come up with is a late invention once they realize that, oh, we got a real problem here. If Jesus is sinless and Muhammad's a sinner and all these other guys are sinners, like the Quran says and the Hadith say, it's going to make our prophet look bad. We can't have Muhammad looking bad, especially against Jesus. So we got to come up with this idea that Muhammad's sinless and all these other guys are sinless, so they can come up to the level of Jesus. And at the same time, they'll try to bring Jesus down a little bit, because they need to get Muhammad somehow, you know, leapfrogging over Jesus, so people will pay attention to Muhammad rather than Jesus. So what we're saying about all this is it's just a fabrication, a modern-day fabrication by Muslim apologists to try to escape what's really going on here, which is the sinlessness of Jesus and his superiority. Okay, let's go to the next point here in this little review. What does the Bible say about who Jesus is? And on your screen, you see some Bible passages. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 22, of Jesus Christ, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. 1 John 3, 5, and ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, for he, God, hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. John chapter 8, verse 46 and 47. Can any of you prove me guilty of sin? Now, how many people do you know that could go around saying that? Can any of you prove me guilty of sin, Jesus said. If I am telling you the truth, why don't you believe me? He who belongs to God hears what God says. The reason you do not hear is that you do not belong to God. Period. Right from the words of Jesus. So, those words from the scripture clearly teach, and there's many, many, many more we could bring up, that Jesus is sinless without sin. And what's amazing here, Steve, and throw anything you want here, is that the Quran testifies to his sinlessness.
Mm-hmm.
The Hadiths testify to Jesus' sinlessness. and the Bible testifies to his sinlessness, yet Muslim apologists refuse to acknowledge this and try to argue against their own holy book as well as the Bible.
Well, many Muslims and many Muslim apologists, actually they will say that Jesus is sinless. But then, like you said earlier, it's almost like they have to leapfrog Muhammad over Jesus. So, I mean, Ahmadiyya might deny it, but other than that, you know, many Muslims, at least the ones that I've encountered and talked to, they will agree that Jesus is sinless.
That's right. Now, let's take a couple other points in this. If Jesus were a mere man, like the Muslims and other people try to say, how could he be sinless? You know, and it, when there's just something about somebody that's sinless and goes through his whole life perfectly, you kind of wonder, how can that man be just a man, like the rest of us? There's something different about an individual that can go through this life and never commit a sin. And that almost gives him almost like a divine quality, because the Muslims themselves say there's no one, only God is without sin and cannot sin. And by implication then, Jesus being totally without sin throughout his entire life, the implication there is he's God. He's God in the flesh.
You got to have something that we don't have.
That's right. Because he's not like your average everyday Joe. There's something about Jesus that's different.
Not even like the other prophets.
That's right. That's way above any other prophet. And when we go to a place like John 1:1, only God in the flesh could go through life and not commit a single sin. And in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. There's your scripture verses on the screen, as well as Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11, which says, and you can read along with me, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Now, how much more obvious can you get from just these couple of Bible references? There's hundreds of Bible references we could give you to substantiate what the Bible's saying, Old Testament, New Testament, about Jesus being God in the flesh, which, of course, Islam and the Quran heartily disagree with. But if Islam is true, the question has to be, why do they have to fabricate this idea about the sinlessness of the prophets? I mean, if you've got a true religion like Islam, why do you have to go and make up a doctrine like the sinlessness of the prophets, which disagrees with your own holy book and your hadiths? What reason could there be to come up with the sinlessness of the prophets idea that violates your own holy book, if your religion is true?
Right. And not only violates it, but, you know, you're talking about an argument from silence here, is that if Muslims believe, at least Sunni Muslims, that all important doctrines about God were in the Quran, then if this sinlessness of the prophets is, at the very least, nowhere found in the Quran, and we actually see it's contradicted in the Quran, then why do you think that this is an important doctrine? Or do you teach this doctrine when it's not found nowhere in the Quran?
That's right. And another point, Steve, is if something's true, does the truth, if they say, like the Muslim apologists say, that it's true that there's a sinlessness of the prophets, if that's true, do you need to substantiate it by lies, fabrications, and falsehoods? Mm-hmm. See, does the truth need help from lies, fabrications, and falsehoods? But we see it can't be true because the Quran already says that all these guys are sinners, but Jesus is not a sinner.
Yeah, and there's a Shiite sect that basically said all of the prophets had the divine inside them. All right. Sure. And so it's like, well, if you can't have a substantiation, then saying they're all sinless has no more support than saying they were all part
right,
of God.
You're just making up stuff, and who's going to believe you anyway? Mm-hmm. But now Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. That's John 14:6. Jesus said he was the truth. Okay? And if he's what he says he was, then that automatically makes him greater than any other prophets, living or dead. He's it. And I think from this little example we've showed here, that it's obvious from Quranic teachings, Hadithic teachings, and the Bible teachings that Jesus is who he said he was, based on the facts, based on history, not just some Muslim apologist getting up here and making claims, or like you said, these religious groups just making statements without anything to back them up. Well, we got that in, Steve, and we're running out of time in the show, but I think that was very important to get that in, and that'll kind of stay with us for the rest of this series on Muslim apologists. Mm-hmm. But I think we have time to deal with one other loose end we left from the first show, and that's going to be a comparison. And Battle, we brought this up on his tapes, a comparison between the Islamic heaven and the Christian, the biblical heaven. And basically, I'd like to start out with this comparison by showing us the viewers at home. There's a chart on the screen from the Quran. It says Surah 9, 72. It says, God hath promised to believers, men and women, gardens under which rivers flow to dwell therein, and beautiful mansions and gardens of everlasting bliss. But the greatest bliss is to the good pleasure of God. That is the supreme felicity. Also in Surah 56, 10 through 14, it says, and those foremost in faith will be foremost in the hereafter. These will be those nearest to God in gardens of bliss, a number of people from those of old, and a few from these of latter times. Surah 44, 52 through 54 says, among gardens and springs, dressed in fine silk and a rich brocade, these will face each other. So, and we shall join them to companions with beautiful, big, and lustrous eyes. Surah 55, 56 through 58, 72 through 74 says, in them will be maidens, chaste, restraining their glances, according to some translations, whom no man or jinn before them has touched. Then which of the favors of your Lord will ye deny? Like unto rubies and coral, companions restrained as to their glances in goodly pavilions, then which of the favors of your Lord will ye deny? Surah 56, 17 through 18, round about them will serve use of perpetual freshness with goblets, shining beakers, and cups filled out of clear flowing fountains. Surah 47, 15, rivers of wine, a joy to those who drink. And also Surah 76, 21 and Surah 83, 25. What we have here, Steve, I'd like you to make comments. I just read them.
Okay.
But maybe you can make some brief comments about what we're talking about in the Islamic heaven.
All right. What they're talking about is a place that sounds very sensual. You can't drink on earth, but you're going to drink alcohol on earth, but you're going to drink alcohol in heaven. In fact, I've heard that one punishment for a Muslim, drinking wine on earth is that he won't be able to drink wine in heaven. It's like, that's kind of odd. Maybe people want heaven a little early, I guess. And then the other thing is they have all of these virgins who are called houris or huris to meet their every need, which maybe sound great if you're a Muslim man. Maybe it doesn't sound as great if you're a Muslim woman. But they talk about gardens with water. Well, the water part and the beauty part, they got that part right. Of course, they could have got that part out of Revelation 22. Looking at what they're looking forward to, it's basically a sensual place. It sounds like
good looking chicks all around to meet your every sexual desire. Is what you're basically saying. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a landscape that to a Muslim living in a desert in Saudi Arabia would seem like a dream world. Rivers and plush gardens. There's lots of vegetation. It's not sand and dirt and dry desert like you get, in the land of Muhammad. So that would seem really good. So it's very physical. It's very sensual.
Yeah, but it's kind of interesting what you say about landscape, because I know some Muslim friends who are from the Mideast, and they actually say that the desert for them has a kind of a beauty. Uh-huh. And it's like, well, then rather than saying that all of heaven has to have the same geography, so to speak, you know, the Bible simply says that heaven, it you know, no eye has seen, no mind has conceived the good things has in store for them.
That's right.
And so, you know, that heaven could be all kinds of different places. You know, for the Christian, it doesn't always have to be only gardens. You know,
that's right. And reclining chairs, and you're sitting there with these young youths coming up and serving you with goblets and mm-hmm. beakers and things of this nature. You get all these servants coming around you, mm-hmm. helping you out. It's almost like how a pasha would live, you know, in one of these temples.
Yeah,
and he's got these servants coming around him, and he's just living it up. You know,
but think about that. For some of the Muslim caliphs, especially some of the early ones who are corrupt, you know, the Abbasids and things like that. It's like, well, what do they have to look forward to in heaven that they don't already have on earth?
That's right.
And it seems like not much.
That's right. Now, with our time flying on here, I would like to get the contrast with the Islamic heaven to the Christian, the biblical heaven. And you can see on your screen now, we have some biblical references. You can just kind of read along. And Steve already referenced to it once, Revelation chapter 22. And just reading in verse 1, it says, "And he showed me a river of the water of life, clear as crystal, coming from the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the middle of it, streets, and on either side of the river was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were of the healing of the nations. And there shall be no longer be any curse, and the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his bondservants shall serve him. Verse 4, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. Verse 5, and there shall no longer be any night, and there shall not have need of the light of a lamp, nor the light of the sun, because the Lord God shall illumine them, and they shall reign forever and ever." Now, as time flies, let me go to the next verse. "But just as it is written, things which eye hath not seen, and ear has not heard, and which have not entered into the heart of man, all that God has prepared for those who love him." 1 John 3:2, "Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what we shall be. We know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him just as he is." And as we know from a biblical text, Jesus did not need beautiful women around him, as John 17 and Revelation, etc., clearly show. And Jesus clearly said, no sex in the afterlife anyway, in Matthew chapter 22, verses 29 through 33. So what we have here, and Steve, you might want to comment a little bit more on it, is in the biblical text, you have this glorious place where God is our light. We're in the presence of God. And you know all those other passages, like in Revelation 4 and 5 and so forth. Mm-hmm. You got the angels going, "Holy, holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty." And people are worshiping God, and it's just glorious, and it's amazing. And the bliss of being in the presence of God and in dwelling in his holiness and his righteousness. It's you don't get this carnal type atmosphere of beautiful women hanging all around me for my pleasure, and guys, little guys coming up to me and serving me with you know, cups and beakers and stuff, and I've got gardens and I'm reclining, and it's like, hey, it's all about me. It's all about me. No, in heaven we see that we're engaged in an ongoing, continual worship of God Almighty in his presence and loving every minute of it and the bliss of that fellowship with God. But when you look at the Islamic heaven, it's like, well, I'm sitting in here and I got these women. I can get them anytime I want. And I've got servants. It's so alien. It's so different.
Yeah, it's sort of like, I mean, I could imagine a Muslim mother or father, you know, telling their son that, you know, we don't want you to desire drinking now. We don't want you to desire, you know, sex with a lot of women now. We don't want you to desire all these things now, but desire them when you get to heaven. While the Christian would say, you know, rather than thinking about yourself as great or thinking about yourself as nobody, concentrate and think about God and what he would want you to do and praising him. There is one other aspect, though, that we should mention, is that in Ephesians it says that we will reign in heaven. Now, we're not going to be gods by any means, but we will reign with Christ on his throne. We won't have our own thrones, but we'll have his throne. and reigning with Christ. So we are going to do things in heaven besides, you know, loll around and just drinking wine all the time. We're going to reign with him and besides praise him. Now, we don't know who we're going to reign over. We don't know what else God is going to do. We know it'll be great and wonderful, but you know, we're going to have a relationship. We're going to have things to do in heaven, as well as praising God, who will be in the center.
Well, yes, praise God for that. I want our viewers to understand that when it comes down to this idea of the Islamic heaven and the Islamic paradise, of course, we didn't even get into the differences. In fact, we've got a couple of minutes here. Maybe we ought to do that before I sign this show off. We'll pick up with Dr. Badawi and his Islamic apologetic tapes in the next show in this series. But just briefly, I'd like to mention the Islamic hell compared to the biblical hell is also quite different. I think, of course, we're just going to summarize this, and we have plenty of information free to any of our viewers out there who would like to write or call our ministry for free literature, get on our mailing list for our newsletters, things of that nature. We also have a website dealing with Islam that I'll have Steve tell you about in just a second. But looking at this doctrine of hell, I know that Muhammad said that most of the dwellers of hell were women. And Steve, from our previous research and the research you've done, did Muhammad give a reason why most of the dwellers in hell were women?
Yes, according to the Bukhari Hadith, they, many of them were in hell because they were ungrateful to their husbands.
Okay, so Muhammad puts most of the dwellers of hell as women. And any other doctrine about hell?
Yeah, when you say most, I think it was majority.
Majority of the dwellers of hell were women. Not that most women are going to hell. We don't want to confuse that. Yeah. He's basically saying that most of the dwellers of hell are women.
Right.
And that's an interesting contrast to the biblical doctrine of hell, which Jesus basically said in Matthew 7 that most people are going to hell. Don't get me wrong. And we're almost out of time here, Steve, so I don't think I'll get back to you here until we sign off. Outside of quickly mention, I will mention the website we have for Muslims.
The website is www.muslimhope.com, all one word, where much of the stuff in these videos will be found on the website.
That's right, because we have plenty of material on this and other subjects. But anyway, to finish up here, folks, the concept of hell in Islam is so different from the concept of hell in the Bible. But right away, I can tell you that the biblical concept doesn't put the majority of the dwellers of hell as being women. There's no sexist concept there in the biblical concept as there is in Islam. But anyway, we're basically out of time. I'd like to let our viewers know we have our newsletter. We have tracts and literature free of charge for those that would be interested in these things. Contact us, write us, whatever, and we'll be glad to help you any way we can. I'm Larry Wessels with Steve Morrison for Christian Answers. Thank you for being with us, Steve. It's great to have you here again. And remember what Jesus said, and we reentered it throughout. He was the sinless prophet. He was the one without sin. So why not listen to the sinless one, Jesus Christ, as opposed to all these other wicked sinners? No offense to Muhammad, but a man that has to repent 70 times a day for his sins, I would think that you might want to give more credibility to the Lord Jesus Christ, who is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. Trust in him, the scripture says. Thank you for joining us. Join us again next time. I could go on and on, but this should be sufficient for now. Don't forget to check out our main YouTube channel, See Answers TV, which stands for Christian Answers Television, also which has over 19 playlists by topic as you scroll down our channel page.
Check out our websites, BibleQuery.org. This site answers 7,700 Bible questions. HistoryCart.com. This site reveals early church history and doctrine, proving Roman Catholicism is not historically or doctrinally viable. MuslimHope.com. This site is a classic refutation of Islam, a counterfeit religion created by Muhammad. Free newsletters are also available.
Hello, this is Larry Wessels, director of Christian Answers of Austin, Texas, Christian debater. My daughter Marlena has come out with a Christian music CD entitled Win This Fight. It has 8 songs that she has written and performed herself. Some of the song titles are Win This Fight, Love Song to My Lord, Vessel to You, Waiting to Hear from You, Jesus Is, and others. YouTube viewers can listen and see Marlena's music video, Jesus Is, right now, free. Just type Marlena Wessels, M-A-R-L-E-N-A-W-E-S-S-E-L-S, in the YouTube search box and click on her video on the page that comes next. If you would like more information about getting a copy of her CD, just email us at cdebater@aol.com. That's cdebater@aol.com. Or give us a call at 512-218-8022. Thank you, and may the Lord bless you and yours. To the